So today we change topic. So we are still in the cosmic ray, in the ultra high energy cosmic ray physics, but we will deal with the detection of the showers of the cascade of particles that is generated in the atmosphere after the first interactions of this very rare cosmic ray, which arrive at the Earth. So before I start, I just wanted to remind you that in the training, I would like to show you how the situation of the cosmic ray propagation works. So Jose Manuel sent around an email with a Dropbox link from which you can, if you want, download both the code and some example simulations. So in order to open this file, you would need to have root, the data analysis framework installed. I don't know if any of you have tried or download and run or look at the files. Did any of you try? I think I'm looking at Yelena because I saw yesterday from her presentation that she's using it. But is there anybody else who tried?
Okay.
I would say you could try in the afternoon for the training, but we also have a second option, which is to look at the data of the Piaget Observatory. So if you like more the second option, we could also do that by simply using this website in which Piaget collaboration has published basically the 10% of the data, and in which we could see what is, for instance, the curve of the calibration or the spectrum. I don't know if we have to vote this, or but since your background is maybe more theoretical, phenomenological, I would say maybe the first option is better, but you can also tell me. I'm open to both the possibilities. So, okay, I just wait at the end that somebody comes to me and express his or her opinion. You're free to do that. Today I want to show you what is to introduce you to the what happens in the atmosphere. So these particles that come and interact with the particles in the atmosphere, produce something, and then we can observe what arrives at the Earth. So this is due to the fact that we cannot observe the primary particle because they are very rare, and they do not arrive because they induce this cascade of particles. I have to say, I think I didn't tell this yesterday, I am, among my activities, I'm interested mainly in the cosmic rays at the highest energies, and I'm interested in their interactions in the extragalactic space and in the sources, and the ambient of some sources, and in the production of the secondary messengers, such as the neutrinos. I am part of the Piaget collaboration, which is this very big collaboration of scientists working at the Piaget Observatory, which is located in Argentina. I will tell you later about that. And within this big collaboration, we have something like 450 scientists. I am the leader of the Cosmic Ray Phenomenology Task Force. So we have something like 12 task forces, which deal with different different levels with the data, so from the raw part to the part which is devoted to the interpretation of the data. So in my task, we work on the interpretation of the spectrum, the composition of what which is the main interest of our group. So we basically use the data and compare them models in order to understand something about the cosmic rays at the beginning of their life. Okay, so this I can show you later some results related to the interpretation. Okay, but about what I'm going to show today, I'm still referring mainly to this book, the DICE book, and then I will also refer quite frequently to this second paper, to this paper, which is a very nice review about the measurement of the quantum brain composition with air shower experiments, which I mean, it's not just about the measurement. You will see, if you are interested to look at that, you will see that there is also some explanation of the theory behind that. I will also show some details, I mean, very, of course, very briefly without going into details, the experimental techniques used at the Piero Gioia Observatory and some results. So, we will see. So I show again this plot, which was shown already yesterday from me and also from Maurizio, in which I just remind you that we are dealing with the highest energy part of the spectrum of the quantum phase, in which the rate of the quantum phase that arrive is very low. So the direct techniques, which would mean that we can directly see the first particle which arrives at Earth, they are not usable anymore, because they would need very, very large detectors, which is not possible, or even the magnetic spectrometry, it is not possible anymore at this energy. So other techniques are used, and I will show them in the following. So what we take advantage of is the fact that the primary cosmic ray, which is basically a proton, let's say, or maybe a heavier nucleus, can interact with the particles in the atmosphere and produce a cascade of particles, which is called extensive air shower, in which a lot of particles can be produced. So we will have different components of this shower, which are mainly, I mean, one of the most important ones is the electromagnetic one, in which we have electrons, positrons, and photons, that is generated by the fact that in these interactions, pions are produced, neutral pions, which then feed this electromagnetic path. We also have a muonic component for the same reason, so for the charged pions, and then a hadronic part. So in this case, you will see in the following that the atmosphere works basically as the detector, as the calorimeter, so in which the particles can lose energy and that we can, in the end, detect. So as yesterday, at some point, I've been showing the equation of transport for, I mean, following the travel of the particles in the extragalactic space, meaning from the source to the top of the atmosphere, which I was showing how the energy can change and how, for instance, the decays of the particles can play a role. Similarly, in this case, we might make use, of course, of this kind of equation, which is, and the idea is of course similar. So we have to follow what is the fate of a particle. So if we want to check what is at the end the number of particles of a certain species I, which can be everything, it can be pions, it can be muons, whatever you want, electrons and positrons, as a function, in this case, of x. So this is the quantity that was probably already introduced yesterday, but it is defined as, so this is called slant depth. And it is defined, so the zero of this is defined at the top of the atmosphere. Okay, while the height of the atmosphere, we define it, the height is zero and the surface level, okay? So this is the opposite. And it is measured in grams per centimeter square. So it is basically the material that the particle can pass. Okay. So of course this is I mean it has a non-trivial dependence on the density of the atmosphere and on the other characteristics like the temperature, the pressure, and we should consider all this. But in any case, we can write this as the integral of the density multiplied by the height of the atmosphere and integrated over the path of the particle. Okay? So this, you see that can give you this units. Okay? Of course, also the height of the, this H depends on other quantities, such as, for instance, the angle, okay, from which I am receiving these cascade of particles. So, can anyone imagine why this is important? So, why the angle from which I receive the cascade of particles is relevant? So, for instance, if I have my detector, which is here, so this is the Earth. And this is the atmosphere. So then I can receive something shower from this direction. Yes, please.
It's less basically atmosphere mass intervening between the signal.
Yeah, detection. That's correct. So your colleague said that. So basically, if I have this and I can measure the zenith angle from this, so the vertical, I will have that. Theta is zero, while so theta is increasing like this. So if I have that the cascade is just coming at zenith equal to zero, I will transfer and will pass through some quantity of atmosphere. While if my cascade is inclined, the quantity of atmosphere that I'm passing through is larger. So this will have some influence in the cascade. So I can imagine that. So can you imagine what happens then if I have some amount of particles that come from theta equal to zero and the other one comes from a very inclined shower?
Well, there are more interactions in between, so I lose my signal.
Yeah, so I lose, or I mean, the signal can change. Yeah. So maybe some parts of some components of the shower will be more or less absorbed. So I will need to take this into account, which is what I mean, people working in this field actually study. But okay, so let's have a look to the quantities that we have here in this. In this equation, which we would need to solve for each species of particles, which of course we don't do. It's just, I'm showing just here just for analogy with what we had yesterday and just to show you how, what are the quantities. So here we are actually using, as I said, this lamp depth. So if we want to define the interaction length, so basically the first quantity that we have here takes into account the fact that I might lose some particles of species I because of what? Because of the fact that they can interact, okay? And then lose some energy or whatever, okay? So if I write this in terms of the units that I want to use in this case, I will need to multiply this, to multiply the length of the interaction by the density of the atmosphere, okay? So if I substitute here the length, I substitute just the cross-section of the process that I have to consider, then in the end, this will be something like considering the mass of the particle divided by the cross-section. So the cross-section of this interaction of this particle with the particles on the air. Okay? While in the case of the decay, so this is the decay, again, in this case, I also have, again, the minus sign, right, as in the previous one. Because even in this case, if the particle has a decay, I'm losing that species of particle which produces something else, okay? So in this case, if I want to write this still in the same units, I have to. So I'm basically using what also Maurizio Studio explained yesterday. So for the decay length, I still have to define it as the speed of light multiplied by the time of the decay in the rest frame of the particle. Right? Then I have to consider what we defined yesterday, so the Lorentz factor of the particle. And this still I have to multiply by the density in order to use the same quantities, like the same units of the Planck vector. So I can lose particles because they can interact. So first, this is the first term after the, so on the right side of the equation, I can lose particles because they decay. And I can instead gain the same. And then I can have some injection of particles of the same species I, because they are produced by other ones. Okay, so this is what the last terms tells us. Okay, so it's similar to what we had yesterday, but different processes. But the equation works in a similar way. So I have a source term and some losses in the shell. So this defines our framework. So we are not going, to solve this equation, because we would need a textbook. This you can find, the book I mentioned at the beginning. We will have a phenomenological approach, as we did yesterday. So in order to understand what is happening at in the cascade, because what is our goal? Our goal is to infer what are the characteristics of the time of the cosmic ray from what we observe at Earth. Okay, because the characteristics of the time of the cosmic ray in the atmosphere, they can help us in understanding the characteristics of the cosmic ray at the beginning of its life. So there is a lot in between. So there is what happens in the extragalactic space, and then there is the atmosphere. Okay, so as I said, okay, so this I didn't introduce yet, but these are then the quantities we want to determine. So we want to know what is the energy of the primary cosmic ray from the characteristics of the shower. We want to know what is its mass. So up to some years ago, they thought it were just protons, but apparently this is not the case. We might also have heavier nuclei in the cosmic ray, which might be accelerated in the sources. And we have to know what is the direction of the shower. So in order to reconstruct these characteristics, we have to take advantage of what we can observe from the shower. So we have two possibilities. One is to look at the shower while it develops in the atmosphere, okay? So this is what is called the longitudinal development of the shower. So in this case, we are effectively using the atmosphere as a calorimeter, in the sense that the atmosphere is doing two things. One thing is that it is a passive material that drives the development of the shower, because it's the particles that come from the outer space interact with the particles of the atmosphere. And it is also the active material, because it can these particles can induce something else, which is, for instance, the fluorescence, the excitation in the fluorescence mass that you can observe. So it is both the active and the passive material that you can use. Okay. In another way, I mean, with other techniques, we can also observe the particles at the ground. So in one case, in the first case, we observe what is happening in the development of the shadow, so not just at the end. While in the second case, we observe what arrives at ground. So the particles that arrive at ground, and then we have to find a way to detect them, to count them, to make them interact at the ground. Okay? So this is basically like as we would observe only the last part of the shower, which you can imagine is something that is arriving with some angle. So in the first case, we observe, let's say, live what is happening in the development, and we see some distribution of particles, and we will see that. While in the second case, we see only what arrives here. Okay, in the last front of the development, we just measure what arises there, what survives, let's say. So this is like a calorimeter, but only with an active plane, which is the last one. And this gives a good geometric acceptance in the end and a high duty cycle. So it means I don't need to, for instance, close the telescope because there is moonlight. These are just particles that arrive at Earth and they can detect them in easier ways. So let's just. But then what do these particles, what are these particles doing in while they cross the atmosphere? So it is written right here, so it's very easy. They can interact, they can decay, so interact or decay. And they can ionize the medium. Okay, these are the things they can do. So let's make an example already with the electrons and positrons, because this is the easiest thing with the basic background in particle physics, which I expect you to have. It's something that we all can understand. So what electrons can do? So how they can lose energy? Yeah, so first is branch travel, which is the easiest way for the electrons to lose energy. So first, they will lose a lot of energy because they are very energetic, and then they lose this energy. At some point, their energy becomes similar to the energy to the so we can define it as a critical energy, at which the radiative losses equal the ionization one or the decay length for other particles. Okay, this is defined, this is 87 Np for electrons. Okay, for muons, this is actually a larger value. So after this energy, the electrons lose their energy by ionizing the atmosphere. So in this case, we really recognize that the atmosphere works as a calorimeter. And if it works as a calorimeter, we can derive the energy of the primary particle, okay, which then produced a lot of electrons, okay, because the electrons are basically almost the entire part of the cascade, okay. So what do? We just we will have a profile of particles, this n of x, so depending on the slant depth, and we integrate that in the depth of the atmosphere. And that is all. So we have the calorimetric energy, we have the energy determined because of the energy losses in a material. Okay, so this is really bad. We have to consider then the energy which goes in other things, like for instance neutrinos, which we cannot taken into account. So there is some kind of invisible energy that has to be considered. So the determination of the energy from the point of view of the calorimetry has to be corrected for something else. So, and this is how you see it later, the energy loss and function of the slant depth works. So you see the x on the y-axis, V over Vx, as a function of the slant depth. Okay, so as I said before, the slant depth is defined as zero at the top of the atmosphere and increases until the ground. So at the ground, we have more or less 1,030 grams per centimeter squared, the value of x at the ground. So this is just an example, and we will go into this later. So I also wanted to add this, which is very important. So we do not only have the fact that calorimetric aspect, okay? We also have to consider geometrical aspects which relate to the fact that and every time I have an interaction, what can happen? I mean, it can happen that the particles don't go just in the main direction, but they are somewhat they can go in the lateral way, and then the shower front is enlarged with respect to, at Earth with respect to earlier stages of the shower. Okay, so this has to be considered, and it is due to the Coulomb scattering, and it has, of course, to be included in the reconstruction then of the shower that we make at the end of the development of the shower. Okay? So we have to consider both the energy losses, but also the geometric aspects. Okay, so let's go then more deeply in the characteristics of the extensive air showers for what we are interested on, so for the mass and for the energy. So the easiest treatment, which is given in this paper, is the one for the electromagnetic cascade. Okay, so what do we expect in this case? So it means that a photon comes, and what a photon can do is exactly what Elisa explained before. Can do it also in the atmosphere, but not only in the extragalactic space. So after one interaction length, there is some probability that the photon can produce a pair of electrons and positrons. Okay. So every time, so let's say, in a basic scenario, I could imagine that every time something happens, this branch is split in two. Okay, so every time after an interaction length, I have that here the energy is split, and here again after another interaction length, the energy is split again in two. Okay, so. If I want to compute the number of particles, so the number n of particles at a certain depth in the atmosphere, well, I just simply have to compute this. So 2 to the power of x, which is the depth in the atmosphere at which I'm looking the shower, divided by the interaction length. So that's very basic. So if every time I consider the fact that the energy is split in two, it is very easy to compute the energy at that level in the atmosphere. It is just the energy of the primary, which is here, first the particle that comes at E0, which is divided by the number of particles, which I can compute easily. Okay, so very basic. I mean, very basic, but then there is stochastic interactions to be considered. At this level, you can say that the energy is simply the energy of the primary divided by the number of the particles. So if I consider what I said before, so I have to consider the fact that at some point the electrons do not interact anymore, but lose energy by ionization. means that they are arrived at some point at this critical energy that we define. So something like energy. So it means that after that energy, I won't have more particles in the shell. So I reach a point in the development of the cascade in which the number of the particles is maximum. Okay, I cannot have more. So where is this happened exactly where I reached this critical energy. So the number of particles at this X max, which is a quantity I will repeat many, many times in the following, is just the energy of the primary divided by the critical energy, okay? So if in the end I want to find where is the position in the atmosphere at which the shower reaches its maximum number of particles, I just have to consider, I would need to have the initial energy. Actually, we do the opposite. We want to know what is the initial energy so that we measure the point in the shower at which we have the maximum number of particles and then we derive the energy. Okay? Considering also the interaction length, of course. Okay? So that plot that I've been showing before with the X and E over X, which is related to N, is something like this. So I measure what is the position in the shower at which I have the maximum of this profile. And this is connected to the energy of the primary particle. Okay, so this is what is done in for the electromagnetic part of the shower. Just interrupt me if there is any question. So from this already, we might be able to really estimate not only the energy of the primary particle, which is a photon, but also the energy of a primary particle that is a hadron, for instance, a proton. So can you tell me why this is possible? So this is bad, I mean, just a particle. So we said that if we have some kind of interaction in the atmosphere, we produce what? We produce a lot of particles, among them we can have pions. And if we have neutral pions, we can feed the electromagnetic part of the shell. Okay? So every time I have, even if I have a proton at the beginning, I feed the electromagnetic part of the shell. Okay? So this is what comes out in the end, that I can compute from the expression we have found before, I can compute also the X max for a shower initiated by a proton by taking into account the fact that I have to take into account the multiplicity of the emission of the first and the other particles, of course, and the fact that if I have electromagnetic showers, every time the energy again is split in two, and this is contained in this second part. So it is possible then to use this estimate of the maximum number of particles in the shower, even in the case of hadronic ones. And this we will see in the following. So what is the main difference then with respect to electromagnetic cascade, if I have a hadronic cascade? It is the number of particles, right? Because I'm not splitting every time. So after one interaction, like I'm not splitting the branch in two, I'm splitting the branch in many. So let's say that so you see here, this N is the multiplicity. I can produce many, many more particles than in the electromagnetic shower. And then, as I said, the generation of neutral pions feeds the electromagnetic cascade, while the charged pions feed the noonic part. And every part will be very relevant for the understanding of some quantities of the primary. Okay? And again, the charged pions interact until they reach the decay energy, which is what we defined before. So every time we have a decay, we have to consider this. And this will be depending also on the place in the atmosphere at which I have this happening because of the density. So then if I want to compute what is the energy that is going into that part, what do I have to do? Again, just consider the pions, so the charged or the neutral, okay? So if I consider this N as the stage of the shower, so after N, so N is equal to one, after one interaction length, is equal to two, after two interaction length, and so on. So I will have that the energy that goes into the hadronic part because of the charged pions to the N multiplied by E zero, which is the energy of the primary. Why? For the electromagnetic part, I have to consider the other, the rest of the energy. Okay? Already with N equal to six, the 90% of the energy is transferred to the electromagnetic component. So it's a lot. Then, what can I say about the particles and ground? So previously I mentioned, so what I mentioned up now is related to the stage of the, some stages of the development of the shell. But what is, what comes then at ground, okay? So what I can measure, for instance, with the detectors on the surface. So let's consider the energy of a pion after the contraction at the end level of my interaction. So the energy of the pion will be just the energy of the primary particle divided by N. Big N is the multiplicity, while the small n is the number of interactions. Okay, so this is the energy of the pion. So at this point, as I said before, the energy continues to split, so the cascade continues to split until I reach the decay energy of the pion. And at that point, so this is reached, I can write this as ND, so the stage of the shower at which I reach this decay energy. And this I can also compute, right? As, so just working out this and taking into account the energy of the pion. Okay? So at that point, the pion decays and it produces. So now we are interested in the particles at ground, so we have to consider the decay of the charged ones, of the charged pions, right? So how many muons I should consider for each pion? So just one, right? So every time you have a pion, then you have a muon, more or less. So this number is the same, and then I obtain, I have 2/3 of N, which was the multiplicity of the interaction, to the power of the of NB, which was the level of the shower at which I have the decay. Okay. So in the end, if you work out this later, you can find that the number of muons at Earth is related to the decay energy, to the energy of the primary, which is this one, to this power, which contains the multiplicity. Of course, this, I mean, has to be supported by simulations, because of course, you have to take into account the multiplicity, which has then some behavior with the trend of the energy. But anyway, this is important just to show that with the previous treatment, so if we look at the shower while it develops, we can have information about the primary energy from the point in the shower at which I have the maximum number of particles. Why? If I just stay at Earth and I see what particles arrive at Earth, we can even in that case have information about the energy of the primary by looking in this case at the muons. So on the other case, it was the electrons, the electromagnetic path, in this case, it is the muons. Okay? So it is a different way to look at the shower. Of course, we need a very different kind of telescope of detector. Okay, so now let's have a look to what we are interested in. So the other observable we want to know is the mass of the particle. Okay? So in a very basic model, one could consider, for instance, a proton as a nucleus of hydrogen. And for instance, if I have an iron nucleus which arrive at the top of the atmosphere, I can consider this as a times a proton. So I can consider just a nucleons which arrive at the top of the atmosphere, okay? So just to recall that the number of particles and the maximum development of the shower is just the energy of the primary divided by the Lipkin energy. That gives me the possibility to relate the primary energy with this X max. While if I have a nucleus, then I can consider its energy, so the energy of the nucleus is E zero, but the energy of a nucleon will be E zero divided by A. And this I have to multiply again by A because I have A nucleons. So in the end, the number of particles for an iron or for a heavier nucleus at the maximum development of the shower are the same as the shower initiated by the proton, okay? But then have a look at the X max. The X max is then dependent on the logarithm of the energy divided by the mass, okay? So this has a strong implication on our capability then to distinguish the composition. This is of fundamental importance when we have to determine this quantity, okay? So we have found something with which we can distinguish the mass. Okay? So as soon as we are able to measure X max, we could be able to infer the mass of the primary particle, okay? Then even in the case of the particles measured at ground, this makes a difference. So if you include this idea of the superposition model in the number of muons that we have computed before, which is this one, you will see then in this case, the number of muons, it is different if we have a shower initiated by a nucleus or if we with respect to if we have a shower initiated by a proton, okay? So why is that the case that I have? So what do you expect? Do you expect to have more or less muons in a, for instance, in a shower initiated by an iron with respect to a shower initiated by a proton? Elephant here. Okay, why? I can hear. So the answer is correct. So I will have more muons in case I have a heavy nucleus. But why is this the case? But this is not the only reason. I mean, the reason is that, so if I have two showers with the same energy, And one is initiated by a proton and the other one is initiated by an ion with the same energy. So in this case, I will have that the proton has energy zero, while in the other case, I will have that the protons, or I mean, the nucleons of the ion will have E zero divided by A, okay? So the energy of each nucleon will be smaller. What does that mean? That the pions that are created from these interactions will reach earlier the energy of the decay with respect to the proton. So if they reach earlier the energy of the decay, they will produce more muons, okay? That is the reason. And also the point at the end is that you will have more particles in that, okay? So that is also important for the number of fluctuations that we will see today. So this is a crucial point, this one that I'm saying here. So if this is not clear, please tell me. The X max depends on the energy. So this is an example to show that. But of course, you will see later that we have also dependent on the energy because of this. That is the problem. It's not that, so if you. We were able to measure or to determine these quantities event by event, that would be easy, but this is not possible. So we are still, what we do is that we can determine these quantities in a statistical way. So that means we have to consider a lot of quantities which enter in this reconstruction, and among them, there is the dependence on the energy and the dependence on the components. But if, for instance, so this was to explain the number of neurons. But if you have, for instance, then to compare two showers from the point of view of their position in the atmosphere, you could do this similar reasoning for the previous case for determining the energy of the ground. Okay, so that means that if you have again two showers that are initiated with the same energy and they have two different masses, what do you expect as the X mass? So, for the same reason I said before, that I expect more muons for the iron, I expect a different value for the X mass. So, it means that since the shower initiated by the iron has, in principle, smaller energies for the nucleons, it means that it reaches its maximum stage in the atmosphere earlier than the proton shower. Okay? So I will see that that distribution is shifting in one way or another if it is heavier or so this is what are there other doubts? Okay, so then we can I just wanted to that was basically the question of the point of this slide. So the deposition in the atmosphere is sensitive to the mass of the primary, and this is this part, and the number of muons is also sensitive to the mass. But these two quantities can be observed with different, very different techniques that we are going to discuss. Then another very relevant point is statistics, how to say, stochasticity of the interactions. OK? Okay, so what I've been showing up now is exact quantities, which is not the case. So I've been showing this formula in which I was showing the lambda, which is the interaction length, which is actually what we are using in this examples is an average quantity. Okay. So what are the quantities that enter in the development of the shower apart from the interaction length? What do you think I should take into account for the development of the shower? So at every interaction, I have to consider what? What is the quantity I have to consider? The cross-section, of course, so I'm considering lambda, so it means I'm considering the cross-section, and then interaction. Let's leave that on the side for a moment. So what do I have to consider if you think the interaction between particles? So I have to consider the probability then. So I mean that what we said before, like the multiplicity. I mean how many particles I'm producing in the last step. And then this is included, it is included, I can include this in the concept of the cross section, right? But I wanted to mention also how much energy I give to the secondary particles. So the elasticity, if you want, right? So how much energy I transfer to the other particles. So all these quantities have to be considered. Okay? So what I've been showing up now is not actually the X max. What we are going to take into account is the average value of this because of these problems, let's say. So I have to consider the cross-section, the multiplicity, and the inelasticity. Okay, so where do I take these numbers, these quantities? Do you know about any experiment that can tell me what is the cross-section of particle arriving with 10 to the 20 dB in the atmosphere with the nuclei of the atmosphere? Is there any experiment that can do it? Do you know? I don't know because there is no experiment that can do it. I mean, because of the energies that we can deal with at the LHC. So the interactions of the protons with the air are constrained at lower energies with respect to what we deal with now. So for instance, the LHC energies that are smaller than the cosmic ray energies. So we have 14 TeV at the center of mass at the LHC, which correspond to the 10 to the 17 TeV in the laboratory system. So it's smaller than what I have with cosmic ray. So this opens basically a big problem because I miss the initial parameters that I need to put into my basically into my model for studying the development. So it looks like we are a bit stuck at this point. So there are several models which are available. So first, there are some extrapolations from the cross-section measurements that are done at LHC, and we show them later. Which it is possible to do it with cosmic ray. And then there are several models that are available with different approaches, and I'm not expert in this, but it is a very interesting physics, which, and these models are tuned on the LHC measurements at lower energies. So you may have heard about EPOS, CBIL. These are all models which treat the interactions of the protons with the air nuclei with different approaches and which give then different predictions for the X-max. So basically I have to attach to the X-max the determination of the mass, which is my goal. But this is dependent on the models. So this leaves space then for interpretation, okay? Which is ambiguous, and we will see it later. Okay, so I just want to mention something about the lateral distribution of the shower. So I mentioned before that we have to consider the electromagnetic part of the shower in which we might have reproduction and branch down. But we also have, because of the Coulomb scattering, the departure, let's say, from the main direction of the shower. And this means, there are ways to parameterize this and this. I'm not giving the details because it's, I think we don't have time, but it is, of course, a function of the distance from the core of the shower. So if I am at Earth and then I measure the shower, not exactly in its main direction, I have to consider this spread. And this is also a function of this S value that I'm explaining later, and of the number density of electrons. This is called the NGK formula. I will show, I'm not showing that, but this is used, of course, to fit some measurements that I'm going to show later. So this S parameter, which is included in this, is instead defined as the age of the shower. It is an empirical definition, and it is depicted here in this plot, the number of electrons and positrons in the y-axis is a function of the slant of that. So one is when basically the shower reaches its maximum, and then it is larger or smaller. So the age is more than one or below one if it is before the maximum or after. So this tells us about some kind of universality aspect of the shower, which is due to the fact that in the shower there are a lot of particles. So we can have an idea of how it works because of statistics, let's say. And this can be also applied in the determination of the proton air cross-section, which I'm not going to touch, but if anybody is interested, I can give the references of the papers, at least of the Clairaugel collaboration. So I think from now on, I want to go more deeply in the detection techniques. So I don't know if you want to make a small break or we can continue. Okay, so sure.
So when does this professionally and in the corresponding program, do you take into account this very simplified model, or do you consider the main multinational? Because for that, you have to see the main characteristics that perhaps it is
Yeah, I mean, it is simplistic, but it is pedagogical, I think, and it is very useful to be understood. It is used with several modifications due to, better approximations of the multiplicity and so on, of the elasticity and all this stuff. But if you are interested, really, I think that with the basic knowledge in particle physics, the paper and the review I was mentioning at the beginning. So if you don't want to go to the textbook, the review I was mentioning at the beginning by they are two scientists of the Clairaugel collaboration, it gives you a very nice overview of how the shower works in terms of approximations, and also it reminds you to more refined models. Yeah. danno valori nello stesso range, ma indipendentemente poi dalla sensibilità dell'esperimento, potrebbe essere che poi la discrepanza tra questi valori è simile all'errore statistico, appunto hai il problema che il tuo modello non riesce a soddisfare, diciamo, l'avanzamento del tuo esperimento, quindi poi niente, se i modelli non migliorano, non puoi migliorare la tua situazione della nostra parte. Allora no, penso che ci sia dietro molto lavoro, no? Non è molto interessante un lavoro e, però le cose che sono da capire sono quelle che dicevo prima, cioè principalmente la velocità e la mobilità, oppure l'altra, diciamo, il sistema ambientale dovrebbe essere sempre più capace di determinare che sia la diventa del mondo, il mondo statistico, forza, in cui a quel punto l'ultima determinazione è la massa. Quindi è, diciamo, un altro punto di vista. Però dal punto di vista dei modelli, non so se va, per essere questo punto, quando si sono le cose. No, no, poi devo posso vedere le discrepanze non sono grandi. Ok, posso vedere il confronto, diciamo. Vai, questo è il valore della media di quella distribuzione. Quindi hai due momenti, il valore medio e la prima variabile. E quindi questo lo devi confrontare con le aspettative che hai da modello. E queste aspettative sono di questa grandezza, di queste bande che sono tipo 20 grammi per centimetro. Nel momento in cui poi il tuo esperimento riuscisse a vedere meno, a sentire meno di quella cosa lì, a quel punto sei nei problemi, perché il tuo modello non si sta seguendo, diciamo, quanto l'esperimento è migliorato, diciamo. E quindi non puoi fare molto.
Anche dopo sarà un po'
sì.
for specific inquiry.
Master Sicilienia.
Can I restart? Let's just start from what we stopped before. So now we are going to see what are the main detection techniques. I mean, just two of them, the one related to the detection at the surface and the one related to the detection of the shovel-like develops the atmosphere. And after this, I can I will show some of the results of the Piaget Observatory, which are related to these two detection techniques. So the first one that I'm showing is the technique, very basic technique, which is related to the arrangement of detectors in a regular pattern on the surface of the Earth. So you see different pictures of these experiments in different places, like this is Tibet, this is Cascade in Germany, and this is Telescope Array, and this is the Piaget Observatory that I will show later. Telescope Array is in the US, so in the northern hemisphere, and the Piaget Observatory is in the southern hemisphere. So the showers are detected by searching for time coincidences of signals in the neighboring stations. And depending on the energy of interest, on the energy range of interest, the distance can vary. So for instance, in the Piaget Observatory, we have these surface detectors and stands which are spaced at 1.5 kilometers, so it's really a lot. So why do we need this very large covering? It is actually, of course, it is not the entire surface which is covered, but the particles in the shower that are inserted, we couldn't cover 3,000 kilometers square of surface, and this is the Piaget Observatory, because of the rate. So since the rate that we can measure, that we want to measure, is basically given by the flux of these particles that arrive at Earth multiplied by the aperture. So since the flux, we cannot change it, it is as it is. But the aperture, which is the surface multiplied by the solid angle, this is what we can enlarge, and this is what is done in this observatory. So then I'm showing here and in the following, not the measurements, but how we want to measure the observables in which we are interested in. So first we want to know the energy of the primary cosmic ray. So what do we do with the surface detectors? We count the particles that arrive in the detectors, okay? So this is done in this case by looking at the lateral distribution function. So basically the lateral distribution of the shower, so what just arrives at Earth, or a signal density at some distance from the core of the shower. So what is done is this measurement of the signal in terms of the VEM, which is the vertical equivalent muon, so that passes through the tank, as a function of the distance from the shower. Okay, so this so what you see here is already coming from a measurement at the Piaget Observatory, but what is done then in the end is to fit basically this signal. So each point corresponds to one of the depths, and then you fit this distribution of signals with a function, which is that one which I was introducing before. I didn't mention it explicitly because it has a form, but then every experiment or every reconstruction technique have different dependencies on the parameters that we don't care about in stage. So basically with simulations, you have to find the distance from the shaft, from the core of the shovel at which your basically your signal is not a lot dependent on the parameters. So you see this function is dependent on these parameters, and then you find in simulations a point at which you are sure that you're not so much dependent on this. And then you have to estimate the energy that you do usually by comparing this with other techniques. So I will explain this hybrid detection technique later. So then we want to determine the composition of the cotton plate. So we said that the number of muons, so what I can measure at ground, is sensitive, quantity to the composition, the mass composition at the beginning of the shower. Okay? So I want to see in my detector, want to measure the number of muons and the number of electrons, and then compare them. This has to be done basically taking into account the hadronic interaction model in the atmosphere, so this we cannot avoid. But this is based on the fact that, as we anticipated before, the iron showers have more muons, and they also have less electrons with respect to the proton showers, right? Because they develop earlier in the atmosphere. So when they have electrons, they are much more absorbed than muons. So they will have more muons and less electrons for in the shower. And this is what is depicted here. If you look like at the iron and proton position of this region in this plot, which is telling us that iron simulations show a larger number of muons and a smaller number of electrons. We have to rely on the fact that we have to use hadronic interaction models which are different from each other, and they give different expectations. We will see it also later. The determination of the composition can be understood also from the timing. So what about the timing? So if I have the shower that comes at ground, I will see that if I have a detector here, and if I have a detector here, I will see what? I will see that the particles arriving at this detector will be delayed with respect to this configuration, right? So if I have that these particles are initiated at a certain height in the atmosphere, I will see that the delay will increase with the distance between the detectors and will decrease with the height of where they are produced. Okay, this is simply geometric. So in this, we can say that the shower is initiated by heavy particles with the same energy of the light particles will be less delayed. Okay, because they are initiated earlier in the atmosphere, I reported before. Okay, so this can be, so the timing, the delay time can be information, can bring information about the composition. In addition to this, the timing can help also in the determination of the muonic and electromagnetic part of the shower. Okay, so this is still a signal in a tank as a function of the time. And what we can see is that the muons arrive earlier than the electromagnetic part. And why this? It's because the muons are not spread in the lateral distribution, spread than the electrons. So they arrive a bit closer to the core of the shower, and then they arrive earlier. Okay? So since the muons bring the information then on the composition in the particle detectors, we can derive some information on the composition because of the timing of the different components. In addition to this, there can be also an asymmetry that can appear. So if I have the shower that comes like this, from basically from the vertical, I will have that the nuance are much closer to the core of the shower, while the electrons are more enlarged. Okay, so they will arrive later and more distant. If I increase the Zenith angle, this, so an early late time asymmetry may appear because of the, I mean, again, because of the geometry. Okay, so if I have that the Zenith angle is very, very large, basically the electromagnetic component will be very absorbed, while the muon component is not absorbed. So I will see basically an asymmetry in the electrons, which I don't see in the muons. Okay, so this also can be an indication. I mean, these are not directly the observables that are used, so it's a bit more complicated than this, but this is the idea how to disentangle the condition. And then the direction, of course, so that can be determined again from geometrical considerations, from the arrival time at the different tanks. So I can derive this theta angle from the delay from one tank to the other. Okay, so these are the ways in which we can determine the mass, the energy, and the direction of the primary cosmic ray with particle detectors. Now, let's see what we can do instead if we are able to see the development of the shower in the atmosphere and why it happens. Okay, if I have a telescope and my eyes, the eyes of the telescope can look at this light, the light that can be emitted during the development of the shower, I'm really looking at it why it happens. So what does it happen? It happens that nitrogen molecules are excited by the passage of these particles, and then the excitation and the change of vibration and rotational states can lead to the emission of fluorescence light. And this is what is observed with these telescopes. I will show you later the telescopes of the Kerogen Observatory, which really can collect this light. Okay. So what we actually use for the determination of the cosmic ray energy is exactly this profile, which is seen by the fluorescent detector. So you integrate the profile and then you have the energy, and that's very easy. This profile, of course, can be parameterized with a function which is called Geiser-Hilbert, and it depends on several parameters, and then you can basically reproduce your data, the data points. This is a shower with 10 to the 19 B. You can reproduce this with some simulations, and then you fit what is the best case. Okay. And from this, from the integral from this, you obtain the energy. So this is the basic determination of the energy. Then the composition, for the composition, it is very what I said at some point before. So the fact that we cannot consider the quantities as I gave them at the beginning, but we have to consider the moments of the distribution, okay? So in these two plots, you see the number of charged particles as a function of the slant depth. So you see the black points are the data in both cases that are compared to expectations from simulations of protons or iron. So this is protons and this is iron nuclei at the beginning. So then you compare this and then you determine what is the composition. From this, one can see already what I was anticipating before. So in on average, so basically what we take at the end is the first moment of the distribution of the X max. So we don't have an exact determination of that. So one can see already that if I look at the simulations, maximum number, the X max in this case is happening a bit, little bit earlier than what happens for the protons. So I want to look at the maximum of the number of particles, and also that the fluctuations are much smaller in the case of the iron shower with respect to the protons. So this means that when I'm going to, for instance, for an energy beam delta I, I'm going to put in a plot the distribution of the X max. So here I have the number of occurrence of the maximum number of the showers for a certain beam. And then I will have a distribution of this maximum number. And then I can take the first moment, so the average, and I compute this. And then I take the second moment, so the width of this distribution. Okay, this will be the observables that I will use to compare them with the expectations from the hadronic interaction models to say, okay, this is iron and this is proton. So the determination of the mass is not done event by event, but it is done in a statistical way. And then again, I can determine the direction also with the fluorescence detectors. So not just with the surface detection. So I have to look at the orientation of the shower with respect to the shower detector plane. From the, again, from the arrival time sequence of the signals at the pixels in the camera. And of course, the reconstruction accuracy depends on how many telescopes can see the same shower. Okay, now we can have a look a bit closer to these detection techniques applied in a real experiment, which is the Tierra-J Observatory. I don't know if you have heard about this. This is the largest experiment observatory ever built for the detection of the ultra-high energy cosmic rays. It is located in Argentina at 1,400 meters above the sea level. It is like composed by more than 400 scientists for a total of almost 20 countries all around the world. This is a hybrid detector. It is composed by two different detection techniques. One is the surface detector, so it means tanks of water. There are 1,660 tanks, spaced 1.5 kilometers, and which are these dots in the picture. And there are also four sites with 24 telescopes in total. So these telescopes for the fluorescence line of the shower. In addition to this, we also have a smaller array in which the tanks are closer to each other to go to smaller energies. And there is also a place in which we have three telescopes which work in a tilted mode. So they can look at the shower before reaching the maximum number of particles or to showers that have smaller energies. In addition to this, there is also, I mean, the technique of the radio detection of the cosmic rays is also an example here with the AIRA part of the detector. And it is also needed, of course, and it's very important to monitor the conditions of the atmosphere because of the fluorescence yield that you want to measure. So you want to know what are the conditions of the atmosphere. So there are lasers that can be used for that. Let's look at one surface detector, so how it works. It is basically a tank filled with water, which is, so this is of course a section of this. in which basically the particles enter and produce some Cherenkov light, which is then reflected in the internal surface of the tank, and then it can arrive at the photomultipliers. There are three of them looking downwards. These photomultipliers, of course, collect this light, which is related to the energy of the particles in the water, and is related to the energy of the particles in the shower. So how this is seen, we have seen an example before. So for instance, this is an example for a shower at 22 degrees in the zenith angle, and this is instead a shower at 80 degrees in the zenith angle. So what is clear is that if the zenith angle is small, the electromagnetic and the muonic part will be visible, while if the shower is very inclined, the electromagnetic part is very absorbed, and what I see is just the muonic part of the shower. Okay? So this is the signal as a function of the time. So muons arrive first, and then arrive electrons. In this case, we have just the muons. Instead, the fluorescent stereoscopes, so we have basically this site, which is an example in which you have six of these telescopes, and these are the apertures of the telescopes. There is then a window through which the light can pass, and this light is reflected into this mirrors that then is they deflect then the light into the camera, and the camera is basically made out of again photomultipliers. So there are 440 of them, which so each photomultiplier corresponds to a pixel as in our cameras. Okay. So and how the signal looks like is like this. So the signal is arriving from here, and then it switches on, let's say, one of the photomultipliers. So one can see already, so for instance, if you look at the colors, you see the purple, which is the first signal in terms of time, and then the blue, and then the green, and so on. Okay, so you see in the PMTs, you see also the development in time of the signal. So you see a sequence of activated pixels. Okay, so in this slide, I'm summarizing what is the hybrid detection principle. So you basically try to use both the detection techniques at the same time, okay? So from the one side, you see the lateral distribution of the shower with your surface detectors, which gives you a signal as a function of the time, which is this game. On the other side, you look at the calorimetric energy, which is deposited in the atmosphere. Okay? So in this kind of experiment that Maurizio Scurio was explaining yesterday, the determination of the energy, so the calibration of the experiment, basically for the determination of the energy, is based on data. It's not based on simulations for this hybrid detection. So it means basically, at the end, every time you observe, for instance, events only with the SD, you can go back to your curve that you found, and you determined in those cases in which you observe both, and then you have the determination of the energy from the SD, even if you didn't observe it with the fluorescence detectors. Okay, so there is a way to, so this is this F38, which comes from this quantity, is not exactly the same, it is translated in another form, while this energy of the FP is exactly what comes out from this integral that I explained before. So this experiment at the telescope array works in a hybrid mode. So you calibrate the experiment with the determination of the energy when you see both when you see the events with both detectors, and then you have a way to determine the energy, even if you observe it the event with the SD, which has the largest duty cycle for the experiment. So, okay, let's go then to the results, so to the things we actually observe first. So, the main thing we can do with the with this, the main thing we, or first, we hope to be able to do is to collect particles and to determine their energy. So we put them in a plot in which you have the energy on the x-axis and you have the number of events on the y-axis. So very simple. So you switch on your experiment. So you detect the particles for a certain time. So you have your experiment with some temperature. You switch it on for a certain time and for you look at some solid angle. So this defines the exposure. The exposure of your experiment. Then you determine the energy. So the event comes, then you have to determine the energy and you have to take into account the possible uncertainties. And then you order them. So you basically order them in beams of energy. So in the end, you compute your spectrum as a function of the energy, which is the number of events that are within your energy beam divided by the exposure, so the time and the aperture of your experiment. Okay, then you might want to multiply this by some power of the energy to enhance the little features, the little departures from the power which is, I mentioned yesterday. And this is what you have. So, first, this is the number of particles multiplied by E square as a function of the energy, and here you have exactly the number of events that fall down in this energy beam. Okay. So in order to enhance this departure, so you see it's not just one particle, it's has some features. And then we multiply this by E cube, and then we also can give fit of this. Okay. So a fit, so just a fit with some with a function which is a series of power law of what we have at. What do we obtain? We obtain the determination of the features of the spectrum. So first, this change of slope here, and the energy at which this change of slope happens. This is a determination of the suppression of the spectrum. Okay, this is not new. We knew that this had to be there, and this is reported in several other papers by the Piaget Observatory, by the telescope array, and by other previous experiments. The determination also of the N-pole, which is here, this change of slope, is also something that was already seen by previous experiments. While this, for instance, this is new. This was not seen before, and this is reported in this paper by the Piaget collaboration. So it's a new change of slope that could tell us something about, we don't know what, about the propagation or the masses, we don't know, okay? But from the experimental point of view, you say, okay, this is what comes out. Then the people from phenomenology or theory try to give an interpretation of this. And then, yes, my favorite sentence about what do we learn from the characteristics of the cosmic rays by looking at the features of the spectrum, which was something I'm working on since quite some time. Then, what is then the determination of the mass composition? These are, so before I just gave you the example of one energy beam. One energy beam, I will have my distribution of X mass. So the distribution of the maximum number of particles at some stage in the shower, from which then I have to derive the mass. But this is actually, so I have to do this for all the energies at which I am, my detector is able to measure. So you see here there are, so it is from 10 to the 17.8 to 10 to the 17.9. So energy beams up to the highest one I can have as a function of the depth in the atmosphere. And this I have to fit with something and then to extract for each of these the value of the mean, so the first moment of the distribution, which is the mean, and then the sigma for each of them. And this is what comes out in the end. So it is the average value of the maximum of this quantity as a function of the energy, and the weight of the distribution as a function of the energy. From this trend with the energy, I can derive something about the composition. But this actually depends then in the from the interactions in the atmosphere. We cannot escape from this. Okay? So different models give different expectations. So what is then the what we can derive from this? I didn't talk about the elongation rate theorem, so that could have helped, but there is no time to demonstrate that. So what we can see is that there is a trend. So the X max has some kind of behavior with the energy, which is like we are going like from, so if this is proton and if this is iron, we are going from something that is in between proton and iron to something that is light, and then again to something that is heavy. Okay, this could tell us about what comes out from the sources, but it, of course it is not easy to tell something from this. In the width of the distribution, what we can say is that at lower energies we have larger fluctuations than at higher energies. So these two observables have different meanings in terms of composition and in terms of other parameters at the sources. So if we have time, we can discuss about them. Okay? So we cannot say just cosmic rays are all protons or all iron. I mean, it depends on the energy and it depends on these changes we are seeing here. So it is a very complex, and this is one of the most relevant discussions in cosmic rays. And but I understand it is a quite complex observable to explain. So if you have questions, just. I mean, at the first look, yes, but they bring different information. So they have to be kept separate in order to understand very well what is their behavior. So the sigma brings a lot of information because it brings not just the information about the fluctuation of the interactions in the atmosphere, but also about the spread of the masses. So the masses, the different masses could be produced already in the sources. So they could come out from the sources already from protons to iron. Or it could be that we have sources that produce large masses, heavy masses, and then it's the propagation that spreads everything. These things could be derived from this behavior, which the X-max cannot. So the X-max is just proportional to the logarithm of the mass, while the sigma contains both the information on the fluctuation in the atmosphere, but also the spread of the masses. It's two different components that I can show later. Then information, of course, we want to know from where, in which direction the cosmic rays come from. Remember, they are charged particles, so we should infer what is the effect of the magnetic field. So that is a very open problem. And it is also, again, very disappointing, because if we had protons, we could have smaller deflections than if we had nuclei. So if we have nuclei, the things are pretty much more complicated, even in this topic. So, but basically what you want to do is you want to see if there is a isotropy in the direction of the cosmic rays or not. And what you do, and this is a quite complex analysis, but this is a very interesting result, because this tells us this is a map of the flux in equatorial coordinates, and this is an analysis of the first harmonic in right ascension, so in the direction of the cosmic rays in terms of equatorial coordinates. And this tells us, since this is the galactic plane and this is the galactic center in these coordinates, that basically we could expect, so if we had isotropy, we couldn't expect a signal at a dipole. While in this case, we see a dipole, and this is directed not towards the galactic center, it's directed somewhere else. So from this result, and this takes a while to be explained, but from this result, we have strong indication or confirmation that this cosmic rays come from somewhere else, not our galaxy. So this was a very important. It is more understandable just to say, okay, I have the directions of the cosmic rays, and then I compare the direction of the cosmic rays to known catalogs of sources. So I try to match the position. I mean, of course, I cannot consider the depth that I'm traversing, but I just consider the position in the sky. So I consider the position of the cosmic rays, and then I compare that to the position of the sources, of some sources, in catalogs. Like, for instance, in this case, this was done with Fermilab sources about certain threshold for active galactic nuclei and star galaxies. So then we put into this analysis the energy of the event and the angular distance between the cosmic ray and the position of the source. And then you find that NXF is found for this kind of galaxies, which are very active ones, and that could, in principle, produce cosmic rays. There are also multi-messenger searches, which, of course, this observatory was not designed for measuring neutrinos or photons, but it is possible to provide some limits. So to provide the sensitivity to neutrinos about 100 PV by looking for inclined showers, and the sensitivity to photons. So no neutrinos and no photons have been ever observed at the Pierre Auger Observatory. But this, one can still give some limits. So this is the limit for the neutrinos, which is the red one, which is similar to, you see, to the asterisk one, which is actually the detector design for neutrinos. And this is the limit for photons, so the second one, which was the one that Maurizio reported yesterday, with which one can already exclude some scenarios for the production of photons. So this means these limits refer to the cosmogenic particles, so to those particles like neutrinos that could be produced in the propagation of the cosmic rays in the extragalactic space. They are not observed, but we can put a limit. There are also searches for coincidence events, like neutrinos in coincidence with the transient events, the TXS that was reported yesterday. It also give no signal, but one can provide still a limit for this kind of searches. This is instead what I was mentioning before, like the determination of the cross section of proton air as a function of the energy, in which you see that the experiments with the cosmic rays can reach the highest energies possible, so much larger than what is done at the LHC. Other results related to shower physics are related to the content of neurons. And in this case, there is a big discrepancy between what is expected from the models and what is actually measured. So this is a quantity on the y-axis, which is related to the content of muons, the function of the energy. This is what is observed, while this is the expectation from the data, from the models. So this tells you that we probably are not understanding something in the shallows, and this is a field of research that is open. I mean, there is a lot of discussion about different models in this, even about Lorentz and Baryon regulation effects in the shallow. And then I'll just come very briefly to the interpretation of the data, so to the models, the astrophysical models, which could help us understanding as much information as possible that we have from the data. So for instance, the spectrum and the composition. So the recipe that we use here is to convolve an hypothesis at the source, which takes into account the fact that that the source emits some power law flux, which is what is predicted by the Fermi acceleration mechanism, which was explained during the lectures by Maurizio, which is what we expect, and we could leave it as a free parameter. Then we basically inject, so we imagine to have identical sources uniformly distributed in the commuting volume. So we take one source as a reference and we distribute it in the universe with this spectra. Then we basically inject this in the extra space, and then we have to consider all the interactions I was mentioning yesterday. So the propagation effects due to the photopion reaction and to the photodisintegration of the nuclei. So with this, I can get some expected flux effect, with which I can fit the data. And then I can derive what is the best reproduction of the spectral index and the source and of the mass composition of the source. Okay, this is what is done. For instance, this is the result I can show directly this in the parameter space of the rigidity and of the spectral index. So this is and the source spectrum light into the minus gamma multiplied by some function of the rigidity, so the energy divided by the charge. And this is what is expected at Earth. So the data points are the black points in the spectrum and in the composition, while the lines are the expected fluxes at Earth subdivided by their masses. Okay? So this tells us something about what could be. So if these are the expected masses, we can infer what are, I mean, this comes from what has been ejected as a source, okay? So we are having here the protons, the group of helium, the group of nitrogen, the group of silicon, and the group of iron. Okay. They all have the same rigidity at the source, which means that they escape with different maximum energies, because the energy is the rigidity multiplied by the charge. And with this, we can reproduce somehow the behavior also of the X-max and of the sigma. The main problems here relate to the theory. So basically what we expect from theory is that the spectral index at the scale from the sources is determined by the characteristics of the shock, so the acceleration, basically. And it should be fixed around 2. So it should be, we should expect something like e to the minus 2. While what we observe from this study is something different, e to the minus 1. So the spectra, the fluxes coming out from the sources are much, I mean, more, how to say, monochromatic. So it's a bump of different masses which come out like this. This is not what is predicted. But this is not the only result about this. I mean, this is a result from the Pierre-Roger collaboration, which is in agreement with many other papers in the recent years. Okay, so this is the first discrepancy that we find with respect to the expectations. The other disappointing result is the rigidity, right? Because what we have here is a very small value for the maximum energy. It is 10 to the 18 point something. So that means, what does that mean in terms of the suppression of the spectrum? It means that probably we are not seeing the suppression of the spectrum as an effect of the propagation, but we see also the lack of power of the sources. So it might be that the origin of the suppression is not only due to the propagation, but also to the sources. And this has also implications in the secondary messengers, because if my source is not able to produce cosmic rays up to the very, very high energies, then also the neutrinos which come from those sources will be shifted in energy, because they cannot, photopion reaction depends on that. In addition, so neutrinos and photons. Okay, so this results many, many implications in the interpretation of the sources. So. So basically what we use to fit the data is this kind of function. It's e to the minus gamma multiplied by a function of the cutoff energy. So in the end, what comes out is the value for this rigidity of the energy. Okay? So if this is very small, it means you are basically at the threshold. So you're not above the threshold to be sure that all the suppression is due to the propagation. It should be also the source, which have also implications in terms of secondary messengers. So you won't be able to see a lot of neutrinos. So that could be why we need something. So, for instance, the ice cube detector, which could observe or they could lower the limit because of the thanks to the ice cube Gen 2. But it's not really useful because if the cosmic rays are not so powerful, it doesn't care from the point of view of the propagation. Another thing is that if the neutrinos are already produced in the source, that is, makes the things easier for this detector. But now we are talking about cosmogenic. So, for instance, this determination of the origin of the suppression of the spectrum is one of the main goals in cosmic ray activity. So, for instance, what I also said yesterday is that this suppression is also strongly related to the composition, to the determination of the composition. This is one of the motivations to build an upgrade of the Pierre-Auger Observatory, in which the determination of the mass will be done in a different way, in order to be able to discriminate better the muonic and the electromagnetic part of the shower. So this way you will be able to separate better the two components and then to have more sensitivity to the mass. Why this? Because the final hope would be still to see if there is some kind of percentage of light masses at the highest energies, so that you are able to do astronomy with cosmic rays. So if they are not very heavy, they are less deflected by the magnetic fields, and then you could try to point their direction to see if there is a source in their direction, okay? There are also future experiments like ground and poema for radio detection and observation of air showers from space. I want to just leave you with the list of open questions, which are the ones I've been reporting during the lectures. For instance, the origin of the flux suppression and other spectrum features. We would like to understand if they are effects of the propagation or and or, because it could be also a combination of them, effects at the sources. Or maybe they could be due to interactions already in the source. So that could shape in some way the flux and the escape from the source, which could not be an exact power law with one simple power law. Then we would like to know if there is a fraction of protons at the highest energies, which would allow us to do some particle astronomy, charged particle astronomy. And this would also help in terms of the secondary messengers. Another big open discussion is on the hadronic interactions. And so in the interactions in the atmosphere, like the muonic component, you have seen that it is totally, it's very different what we get from the data and what we get from the simulations, or maybe also new physics that we could discover with quantum gravity. So the future steps are first to collect more statistics, to have a better composition sensitivity with this upgrade, and from the model point of view, to have more multi-messenger studies. So studies in which you don't look only at the cosmic rays, but you put them in relation with the other messengers, like neutrinos and photons, and to improve our understanding, our ability to build new hadronic models. So I hope I convinced you that this is a very large field of research, and there are many open questions that from the particle and astroparticle point of view are very interesting, and it is worth to study them.
Thank you.